Grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you all.
And also with you.
A very warm welcome to our celebration of the Eucharist on this fourth Sunday after Trinity. We begin our worship with the hymn number 642, Amazing Grace, How Sweet the Sound That Saved a Wretch Like Me.
We join together in the words of the Collect for Purity. Almighty God,
Almighty God,
to whom all hearts are open, all desires are open, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. As we prepare to celebrate the presence of Christ in word and sacrament, let us call to mind and confess our sins. We kneel. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned in thought and word and deed, and in what we have left undone. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may walk in newness of life, to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy on you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in eternal life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
We stand to sing the canticle, Gloria. Today's colic, let us pray for the mercy of God. O God, the protector of all who trust in you, without whom nothing is strong, nothing is holy, increase and multiply upon us your mercy, that with you as our ruler and guide, we may so pass through things temporal, that we finally lose not the things eternal. Grant this, Heavenly Father, for Jesus Christ's sake, our Lord. Amen.
The reading is from Romans chapter 6, beginning at verse 12. Therefore, do not let sin exercise dominion in your mortal bodies to make you obey their passions. No longer present your members to sin as instruments of wickedness, but present yourselves to God as those who have been brought from death to life, and present your members to God as instruments of righteousness. For sin will have no dominion over you, since you are not under the law, but under grace. What then? Should we sin because we are not under law, but under grace? By no means. Do you not know that if you present yourself to anyone as obedient slaves, you are slaves of the one whom you obey, either of sin, which leads to death, or of obedience, which leads to righteousness. But thanks be to God that you, having once been slaves of sin, have become obedient from the heart to the form of teaching to which you were entrusted, and that you, having been set free from sin, have become slaves of righteousness. I am speaking in human terms because of your natural limitations. For just as you once presented your members as slaves to impurity and to greater and greater iniquity, so now present your members as slaves to righteousness or sanctification. When you were slaves of sin, you were free in regard to righteousness. So what advantage did you then get from the things of which you are now ashamed? The end of those things is death. But now that you have been freed from sin and enslaved to God, the advantage you get is sanctification. The end is eternal life, for the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We stand to sing the hymn 495, Jesu, Jesu, fill us with your love.
Thank you.
Hear the gospel of our Saviour Christ according to St. Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Whoever welcomes you welcomes me, and whoever welcomes me welcomes the one who sent me. Whoever welcomes a prophet in the name of a prophet will receive a prophet's reward. And whoever welcomes a righteous person in the name of a righteous person will receive the reward of the righteous. And whoever gives even a cup of cold water to one of these little ones in the name of a disciple, truly I tell you, none of these will lose their reward. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Lord, open your word to our hearts and our hearts to your word. In Jesus' name, amen. The human body is a truly amazing thing. Whenever we find ourselves in a dangerous or life-threatening situation, our body responds by trying to do everything possible to preserve life. We find ourselves filled with a level of adrenaline we didn't know we had, and able to do things we didn't think we could. And it's very simplest. It's impossible to hold your breath and cause any damage because instinctively your body reacts and forces you to breathe. Psychologists talk about the fight or flight mechanism that is built inside our DNA that causes us to try and do everything possible to keep our life going. And there's a desire, both learned and instinctive, to preserve life. We can see it in so many different ways. All around the local area, we've installed defibrillators. People have been trained in CPR, again, to try and preserve life. We sit at hospital beds and we ask and beg the doctors to do everything they possibly can to keep life going, even though deep down we know that the end is near and the quality of life is diminishing. But no matter how much we know that, when it comes to that point where treatment has to be withdrawn or life support machine switched off, it is still an incredible trauma because we want to do everything we can to live and to keep others alive. It doesn't matter what we do. Eventually, all of us will reach the end of our allotted span. Our time is up, our days are over, our life on this mortal earth come to an end. And there are only two certainties in life, death and taxes. And you can do everything you can possibly to avoid paying taxes. You'll never avoid it completely, but we all do our best to avoid. But we can't do anything to avoid death. Death is the absolute certainty in this life. What isn't certain is what happens next. We make a decision, a choice, about what happens next. Paul describes it as wages or a gift. For the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Jesus Christ. We choose sin or grace, life or death. We can choose a life of sin, a life apart from God and outside the will of God. And we, at the end of it, we will receive what we have earned, our wages. Or we can choose to follow Christ. But this time, there are no wages, just a gift. It's a no-brainer of a choice. And yet, how many people choose death? Maybe some of your friends or family or loved ones have made that choice. Maybe, as a church, we don't proclaim the choice clearly enough. Maybe, as individuals, we don't lead others to Christ simply enough. And maybe they just make that choice for themselves. The extraordinary thing about grace is that it is a free gift. There is no qualification, no exams to pass, no hurdles to jump, or no work to undertake to earn it. Free, unmerited, undeserved. And it comes from that choice to follow Jesus, a choice to commit to him, to his word, to his teachings, to his example, to his way, to walk in his path and to mirror his life in the world. Following him is completely free. But there's also a cost. There is a cost in the things that we have to give up. There is no cost to receiving God's grace, but there is a cost to following and living out that path. But what is sin? We talk about the wages of sin, but what, at the most basic and simplest, what is sin? I would love to take a microphone and do a questionnaire around the church this morning, put you all on the spot, walk up and down and say, what do you think sin is? How would you describe sin or define sin? I can see some of you starting to panic already. Don't worry, I'm not going to do that today. One of these days I just might put you on the spot. So let me start with an easy definition. Sin is doing something bad, something wrong, something that is evil or that hurts another person. Does that sound like a reasonable start for a definition? It probably does. So I want to challenge you to think completely differently. I want to think about a much bigger sense of a vision for both sin and the kingdom of God. Sin is anything that's not in the will of God. Do you remember a few years ago, it was very popular to wear a little bracelet that said WWJD. What would Jesus do? Well, that's a good starting point. What would Jesus do? If what we're doing is something Jesus would do, it's probably good. If what we're doing is something Jesus wouldn't do, it's probably sinful. That sounds good so far. So let me ask you another question. Is it a good thing or a sinful thing to feed the hungry? Well, obvious answer, WWJD, what would Jesus do? Jesus would feed the hungry. Because Jesus told us clearly to go and feed the hungry, heal the sick, clothe the naked, visit the prisoner, and so on. So we're doing what Jesus tells us. But, and here's the key bit that I think most of us overlook most of the time. If we're doing it to feed our own pride, our own self-importance, or our own vanity, then something good becomes sin. We can fall into the trap of the sin of pride and vanity and self-centeredness and arrogance. You see, when we talk about sin, we tend to think of action, of things that we do or don't do. But when Jesus talks about sin, he talks about the inner motivation of the heart. In other words, we can do all the right things, but do them for all the wrong reasons. We might still achieve a lot of good, but it'll still be sin for us. Jesus digs beyond the surface. He says, if your eye causes you to sin, pluck it out. If your hand causes you to sin, chop it off. In other words, Jesus isn't looking at an action. He's looking at what is it that motivates us before we even get as far as doing an action. What is it in the heart that's causing us to sin and deal with that? The wages of sin, the gift of God. Grace is another word that maybe we don't quite understand at times. Grace is God's free, unmerited, unearned love and favour and mercy. Grace is that we are trapped in sin. We, in our own strength, can do nothing but sin. But Paul, elsewhere in Romans, says all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. We are separated from God and can't do anything ourselves to fix it. For hundreds of years in the Old Testament, we read the story of the children of Israel trying to fix it by following the law. Moses is given the law in Mount Sinai. The children of Israel try and live it out. A scrupulous observance of the law and the Torah. But they can't manage it. They can't reach that point of perfection, of absolute righteousness and pure total holiness. And just so often we do the same. If I was given £1 for every time somebody says to me, well, I don't do any religion, but I'm a good person, I could probably retire now. I'd probably have enough to retire on and live for the rest of my life. I hear it so often. I'm a good person. Don't do any harm. Don't do anything bad. I give to charity. Now, I'll never criticise someone for being good. The world needs more good people, more of the time, doing more good. And we should encourage that always. But being good doesn't take you from the wages of sin to the gift of God. Because we can never be good enough. Some of you are quite good. A few of you are very good. I don't know if I could stretch to say any of you are exceptionally good. Maybe one or two of you are at the exceptionally good level. But none of us can ever be good enough. And that's where Jesus comes in. There was no other good enough to pay the price of sin. He only could unlock the gate of heaven and let us in. On the cross, he pays the price of sin. And he gives us a gift. His life for ours. And that's why it is Paul talks about the wages of sin. But the gift of grace. The gift of life. Because we can never earn it. We can never be good enough. And you know, over the years, one of the questions I get asked from time to time, it comes up fairly regularly, is, do I believe in hell? And the answer is a clear, emphatic, and unambiguous yes. I absolutely believe in the reality of hell. I have no doubt whatsoever that hell exists. I don't necessarily believe in a lake of fire and a little red man with a tail and a pointy trident. That's medieval artwork. It's not scripture. I have a suspicion that hell is the place where you get everything that you want. The place where you get everything, maybe I should say everything material that you want. Everything you dream about and lust over and want is there. But there's no love. And it is that sense of loneliness, that sense of lovelessness in the midst of abundance that is real hell. Because hell is simply separation from God and his love. To live without love is a terrible thing. And I'm not talking about the love necessarily of a partner, of a family member, a friend, a relative, a parent. But to live without the love of God is a terrible, terrible thing. Because it is in the love of God that we find our inherent dignity and value and worth and who we truly are. We suddenly realize who we are and we know that we're loved by God. And to live without that is to live in hell. Because we spend our lives looking for love and looking for dignity and looking for worth and looking for value and looking for satisfaction in things that become more and more destructive. And we fall into a spiral of self-destruction. Sometimes we think we're coming out of it and we discover what we found is transitory and fleeting and disappears too quickly. And the downward spiral continues and continues and continues. At the end of the day, the choice is simply to love or not to love. To love and to be loved and to know ourselves loved by God. Or not to love. The wages of sin is death. But the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus. Life and love, death and hell. The choice is yours. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
We stand to profess our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God.
We believe in one God.
The Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate with the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory, both the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We live for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Let us pray. Lord, we pray for your church, that knowing your light in our lives, we may help others to see it in a world of darkness and confusion. Lord God, hope of the nations, whose Son came as the light of the world to show us the image of love and to teach us the ways of peace, nurture in our hearts the hope he brings, that in a world of suffering, uncertainty and cruelty, we may be a people of healing, wisdom and hope, that in ways large and small, we may show to others the reflection of your love and peace. Lord, in your mercy, we pray for Peter, our rector, Donna and the family, John, our bishop, James and all those in training for God's ministry, and for our churches, Donoughmore and Donoughmore, for all the organisations and all those involved in the life of our church and community. Lord, in your mercy, we give thanks for our homes and loved ones, and pray for all who share in our lives, for the encouragement and help they give us. We ask you to lead and guide them in all they do. We pray for families and individuals who seem to have lost their way and who feel life has no meaning or purpose. We pray for all visitors and all who are travelling or on holidays. Give them and their loved ones your protection. We remember especially the children at this time on school holidays, and students taking up summer employment. Bless and lead them in safety. May they know your love and guidance in their lives and future. Lord, in your mercy, we pray for Charles our King and all in authority under him. Give wisdom of mind and strength of character to those who are called to positions of leadership. We pray for peace in all conflict and war-torn places in the world. Remember especially women and children caught up in the violence, poverty, grief, and fear inflicted upon them. Lord, in your mercy, we pray for all who have fallen into sickness, weariness, pain or depression, those who feel unloved or unwanted. We ask your blessing upon all those in hospital and those who are being cared for at home. We pray for all carers and all who are worried or anxious about loved ones. Lord, in your mercy, we give thanks this morning that you rescue us from death and offer us your peace and your joy. We remember friends and loved ones who are departed from us, those who have been recently bereaved. Lord, comfort and support them. Lord, in your mercy. And we say together, Merciful Father, accept these our prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Christ is our peace. He has reconciled us to God in one body by the cross. We meet in his name and we share his peace. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
The hymn of the Offertory, God everlasting, wonderful and holy. Christ, our Passover is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us celebrate the
peace. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
Father, almighty and ever-living God, we praise you for your goodness and your love. When we turned away, you did not reject us. You came to meet us as your son, as your children, welcomed us as your children, and prepared a table where we might feast with you. In Christ you shared our life, that we might live in him, and he in us. Lord Jesus Christ, our Redeemer, on the night before you died, you came to table with your friends. Taking bread, you give thanks, broke it, and gave it to them, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." At the end of supper, you took the cup of wine. "Give thanks and said, drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me."
Lord Jesus, we ask you, you are
our true life. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Holy Spirit, giver of life, come upon us now. May this bread and wine be to us the body and blood of our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, blessed Trinity, with your whole church throughout the world, we offer you this sacrifice of thanks and praise, and lift our voice to join the song of heaven, forever praising you and singing. Thanks be to you, our God, for your gift beyond words.
Amen.
Our Father,
who
art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, power, and glory,
forever.
The bread which we break is a sharing in the body of Christ.
We live in the name of one body, for we all share in your bread.
Sacred table, not because you must, but because you may. Come not to declare that you are righteous, but that you desire to be true disciples of our Lord Jesus Christ. Come not because you are strong, but because you are weak. Not because you have any claim on heaven's rewards, but because in your frailty and sin, you stand in constant need of heaven's mercy and love. Draw near and receive. Eternal God, comfort of the afflicted and healer of the broken, you have fed us at the table of life and hope. Teach us the ways of gentleness and peace, that all the world may acknowledge the kingdom of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Almighty God,
Almighty
God, with the spiritual food of the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ, through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Set us out by the power of your Spirit to live and work for us. to your praise and glory. The peace of God which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you always. Amen. All of the upcoming services and events are on the announcement sheet. Just one thing which isn't there, and that's there'll be a vestry meeting on Wednesday at 8 o'clock in the Burgess Room. Our final hymn, number 80, Great is Thy Faithfulness.